recording?
Oh, here we go.
Thank you.
Actually,
we're up to record Chris Pearson's over.
I'm not going to tell you all the stories I did, but one thing I'll say is, I thought I was going to have a younger audience for this thing. So you guys are going to be a little bit harder to gee whiz, and so I just have to ask your patience. But I think I will pass this around. These are, and you can take them out and look at them if you want, but handle this stuff carefully, please. These are postcards. A big chunk of this is a personal reminiscence about my father, who launched V2s in the late 40s. So I'll tell you a little bit about him. But why don't I start some of this stuff around so there's plenty of time to look at it. These are postcards that he sent me when he was on the program, and I was about 4 years old. And if you're not interested, just pass it on. This is my dad. He was... because, you know, it's that generation, it's an interesting generation, different now. He grew up in Cleveland, and he was a very mechanical guy from the beginning. When he was 5 years old, he tried releasing the brake on the family truck coasting down a hill. And when he was 13, he took the engine apart without telling his parents. And the guy who put it back together, he let him put it back together, but the guy who put it back together said, you know, he had it so well organized, he thought he could do it. So he was a fabulously mechanical guy and a real problem solver in a lot of different ways. And he didn't go to college. He did aero and automotive. There was a very good technical school in Cleveland at that time. And then about the time the war started, he went to Kent State for a couple of years. And then he was an engine inspector at Allison for a while in the civil service, then he was drafted. So, and about that time he got married. I was born in 44, I was a war baby. And this is me, I'm about 5 years old. This is just shortly after the period we're talking about. This is probably in 49 or 50. And my brother was born just after the war. So, when he got to Wright Field, he got involved in aircraft instrumentation, and he worked, I think the last time I know it was, you know, the hangars down at the end of the runways where they have the presidential planes and so forth. I don't know if it's still there, but the branch he worked in, this was long after he left, moved, so it was in that same building. And he worked on, so he was there until 60, and then he became a manufacturer throughout. Hmm? This is just digitized color slides. That's not what
No.
So one of the things that was interesting, I think, about being a civil service project engineer is you've got to be involved in a whole lot of different projects. Oh, I think, just show me one image from either one of those files, because one of them are good images and one of them are bad. One of them is processed and one. I think that's the good one.
Okay.
Yeah, because the others are the same images except not de-aged and they're very dark.
Okay.
And so he was on the, for example, one of the big issues after the war was increasing range of bombers, especially in other aircraft. And he was on the Lucky Lady 2 project, which was they flew a P-50 bomber around the world nonstop with mid-air refueling. He had a letter of commendation for that. Another thing he did he was very proud of was by a few months, the first supersonic fighter plane was the F-100. The MiG-19 was just a little bit later, and they were both so screwed up that it's, you know, there's a lot of haze in there. And these things were piling up out at the North American plant because they didn't have Mach meters for them. And he came up with a way of modifying another Mach meter so it could go in the F-100 panel, and they actually gave him a substantial reward for that. They had a program to do that. So one of the things that came along, he also, if anybody's interested in this, they can ask me about it privately for a number of reasons. But he was involved in a project where he actually flew on a test flight with Chuck Yeager in a troop glider in 47. So we stole a bunch of V-2s from the Soviets, which is the stuff that went to White Sands. That was actually Soviet V-2s that we took out of there before they could get to the middle there. And we started firing them, and he was brought in as a project engineer on a study of atmospheric heating on reentry. So that was really important, cutting stuff, looking at how the airflow would heat this thing up as it came back into the atmosphere on different locations on the rocket. And of course, with the V2, it didn't get that hot, although the heating may have contributed. They had a major problem with the V2, which is they would blow up in the air. And I may have this wrong, but I think one theory was that the residual propellants were being overheated and overpressured in the tanks, and they were blowing up. That was what, I don't know if you were here for the last time, but Von Braun was just barely missed by a V2 once because he wanted to see these things coming back in to see if he could figure out what was going on. And there's also, well, I'm going to make one digression here because it's such a screwed up story and people are starting to believe it. There's some guy about 10 years ago, 20 years ago, who went to Europe and he wrote a book about the hardened V2 sites in France that were never used because they were bombed. And he found a drawing, a very strange drawing of a V2. And his conclusion was that they were going to use the V2 to launch radiological weapons from these sites. And I've seen that show up in a book that otherwise, well, actually, maybe I'm thinking of the Heinkel 177 P38, so can that for a minute. But anyway, so he wrote this book, and he never considers the possibility, number one, launching a radiological weapon out of a very unreliable rocket from a hardened site is pretty much guaranteed by the end of the month. Nobody's going to be going anywhere near that site because it's going to be hotter than hell there. So the whole book didn't make sense on that ground. But the other thing was that drawing was done about the time that the V2s were coming apart on these test flights into Poland, and they were trying to figure out why they were disintegrating. And he never thinks that maybe this strange modification was an attempt for a temporary reinforcement of the vehicle to see whether that would keep them from coming apart. So if you run across that theory, give it as little attention as possible. So this is a model that was built probably in 1947 at Wright-Patterson Air Force Base. And I don't know if you can see it, but they're little black dots. Everybody see their little black dots? Here's a row of them. So these little black dots represent thermocouple locations. A thermocouple is a kind of electronic thermometer. And they were attached with a little bolt. And so the idea was as this thing came back in, they could record temperatures by that method. And as is sort of common with any pointy rocket that you own for a long time, it's not pointy anymore. Dad was involved in four launches, and the first one, the last three all worked pretty well. The first one, which I've been spending some time trying to figure out what it was, but it turned out it was pretty easy when I looked at a phonograph record that I'm trying to digitize. The first one he wasn't there for, and the rocket crashed, and it turns out, if you look at a table, there are lists of, you know, like in Billy Lye and elsewhere, there are lists of all the American launches. There's a launch, I think it's after 27, that's SPEC, some kind of, it was a special unnumbered launch, and I don't know why that was. And that was November 20th, 1947. That rocket, it took off, it went up 13 or 16 miles, about 70,000 feet, and then came right back down and crashed about a mile and a half away from the launch site. And I haven't heard the record in years, and my brother had it and didn't realize it, but I was hoping to digitize it for this, and I didn't get it done. But on the record was done on a wire recorder, and the first side, these people were not, at White Sands there was this big blockhouse with extremely thick concrete walls. The people didn't always stay in the blockhouse during the launch. My dad watched one launch, the first launch that he saw, he watched from under a nearby truck, and he said when the engine lit up, he thought maybe that hadn't been such a great idea. Well, these guys were in some kind of a shack near the launch site. So this thing was initially recorded with a thing called a wire recorder, which has been obsolete for about 60 or 70 years. And the wire, at least on this one, didn't run long. So you hear a bunch of chatter, and you hear the engine start, and then they ran out of wire. So you flip the record over, and it's post-launch, and these guys are sitting around talking, and they're all kind of, cheery and giggling, because when the thing went it looked to them like it was headed right at their little shack, which wasn't going to give them a lot of protection. I'm supposed to be wearing this. This is what I'm going to do. Hold on a second. Oh, this is the cap that he wore at White Sands almost 70 years ago. And he said that when he came in off the range once, I think it's gypsum. There's a fine powdery sand out there. And you would get covered with this white dust when you came back. And he was walking down the hallway, and he said hi to one of the guys. And the guy just walked right by him. And then when he got into his room and looked in the mirror, he realized he couldn't recognize him because of the dust all over his face. So that first one. Now, the pictures that I'm going to show you were made before he was at White Sands. And I suspect that they're that November 20th, 1947 round that crashed. So he had an army photographer. He wanted to familiarize himself with the launch procedure before he went out there. And it occurs to me that there may be a way to confirm whether it's that round by looking at the shadows and seeing what time it was launched, because we know what time all of these things were launched, and they were all over the place. So what do I do when I
can run the pictures, you can just say...
Why don't I go through the pictures, and then I'll talk about his role in the Arabic program, and if there's time left, you can either leave, or I can talk about some other random things. So this is a picture of the facility, and again, this is November of 47. I think the program had been firing stuff off for about a year at this point. And you can see that there's not a lot of color in the desert. And some of that is that these slides are a little bit washed out, but they're pretty good. Let's go on to the next one. I think they digitized it out of position. But here we see the round being moved on the Meilerwagen. And go on to the next one. Okay, so here's why this series is interesting. It starts off in the assembly hangar and carries us step by step through. And my suspicion is that there's no other color photography of this quality of any single round. I could be wrong, but I've never seen anything like it. So here we see the tanks that... this thing looks almost yellow here. I don't know if that's an artifact or if that's... I don't think that's real, unless this might have been another round that was in the hangar. The guy took and you can see the outflow pipes at the bottom. This is the top of the missile. Go ahead. Okay, and here we see the engine mounted on this, the whole assemblage, but the lower skin is not there. And the fins, one of the things that's interesting, one of the first advances that was made after the war was that the the V2 had fuel tanks, and then around it was wrapped a body, and somebody very quickly said, well, why don't we make the tanks the body and save a lot of weight, which was super critical on missiles then and today. And somebody once asked Von Braun about it, and the answer wasn't very satisfactory. He just sort of said, well, we weren't thinking about that. Okay, so why don't we go on to the next one? So here, the thing is pretty much in one piece at this point. And I don't think there, you know, one of the parts of the control system, they had these movable tabs out here, but there were also vanes made out of graphite that were actually in the nozzle and deflect the nozzle. And unless it's this, but they should be black unless they have some kind of surfacing on them. So I don't know if they're on there. And this looks like this is a different round. And notice this is definitely not yellow. This is white. So I think that's our round.
Is okay. That a number on the fin right there?
Oh, I never noticed that. It's something. Gee, I don't know what, it doesn't look like a number to me, but it should be. That's very interesting. Good spot. Okay, let's go on. Because I'm on the pictures of it erected, I've never noticed numbers, but I haven't looked at these very much. Okay, so I think what we're looking at here is this shadow is the door of the hangar, and we're looking outside the hangar. And notice the DaVinci's job. Military vehicle. Okay, the next and you know, I haven't checked through this thing to against the numbers, and these may be a little bit out of order. But anyway, this shows a very nice picture of the motor and all that plumbing and stuff, and it's a little bit of a complicated mess. One of the things that they did a lot of work on. And I think they finally developed a single injector. They didn't like the system very much, but the single injector came along later. You see these little plugs, each one of these is a fuel injector, and there were, 28 or something like that. So that's a nice picture of the whole propulsion system there.
Is there any chance maybe you could stand around the other side? Well,
it's you.
Oh, I'm in the way. Why don't I get on this side? This is going to work better if I'm over here, even though I can't see it now. Okay, go on to the next one, sorry.
Thank you.
Okay, well, see, this definitely looks...
That's a definitely different round, because the paint pattern is different. It looks yellow and black.
Yeah, like the one at the beginning.
Yeah, that's the same checkered pattern that the yellow and black ones had.
Yeah. Okay, let's go on to the next one. This looks like it's our round again. And the thing is pretty much the same. Do you know what this thing is here? I don't know what that is. Looks like a little kind of hatch or something.
I know that there were a lot of things that were kind of stuck under the skin between tanks.
Okay, why don't you do the next one then? It was hot out there. And would you believe it, they smoked cigarettes?
Well, the alcohol wasn't really in yet.
Okay, next one. Okay, so now they're rolling it out. They're getting ready to roll it out of the hangar. I think it's probably, at this point, my guess is the thing is intact. It's got these bands here, which I assume are being used to hold it to some kind of framework or something. You don't want to drop them on the floor. That's always really bad, even if it doesn't land on your foot. Next one. Okay, I think they're...
lifting straps are in place.
Yeah, you're right. They're lifting it onto the... With these frames, and here's a block and tackle up here. Okay, and notice this guy, the guidance system here. This is the low speed guidance system, especially for when you're in reverse. This is a progressive series, and it shows us leaving the construction hangar, the assembly hangar. Okay, I like that picture. Okay, let's go ahead.
OSHA rules weren't in effect, huh?
So now we see it coming out, and it's in the sunlight. It's from a different angle. Okay, so this is probably, that picture that's out of position at the beginning is probably near this one in the correct sequence. And we see, at least on this side, there's a very simple pattern. There's one black pin, and I think this pin is black over here.
Yeah, the 1946 one, I spent quality time with Dan Stuffy's V2 videos. So
yeah.
The black fin there is the downrange fin on the north side. And then the one you see a little bit of black on, the other side of the rocket is like black on the top. The other side of the tail section is black on the top on one side and black on the bottom on another. So that's a standard late 46 paint scheme before around 11 when they started putting numbers on the fins. So I don't see numbers on the fins.
Well, are the numbers round numbers?
Yeah, there are round numbers that started around 11.
But there was no round for this one.
Okay.
This is that unnumbered one. I think it's between 27 and 28, there was a round. And I don't know why that was. I have ordered, by the way, if anybody gets insanely interested in the V2, I've never seen it, so I'm not sure what's in there, but General Electric was running a lot of this thing, and there is a final report that you can get from the WSMR, the White Sands Missile Range Museum. It's kind of expensive. You can get it on a CD. I've ordered it, but I haven't seen it yet because I was hoping it would give me more light on which specific rounds my dad was on. I'm pretty sure. I'm not positive this is the special round. It's my suspicion. So I could be wrong about that. Okay, let's go on to the next one. Okay, nice close-up of the back end of the vehicle. Notice the early, I think that's either a very late post-war or a very early post-war or very late pre-war vehicle. And there's, you know, you're seeing some various kinds of mysterious garbage all over the place. I have no idea who these people are, and it's probably way too late to figure it out. I think there used to be a website of ex-White Sands guys. I don't know if it exists anymore, but the ones from this period, you know, even the young guys would have to be pushing 90.
Places like Edwards actually had class yearbooks that had face photos of everybody on staff from both the contractors and from military.
Uh-huh.
And we found a few of those for some basis where some of our guys were at. So it's been a helpful thing for when we're looking at the people at a museum to work with.
Uh-huh.
So there may have been yearbooks from those days.
Although I would have thought that the museum people would have tried to put that online, because the kids, of course, are very interested, and there are some exchange, and there was a reunion, I think, within the last 10 years, but at this point it's mostly kids rather than the...
It's usually private individuals will find one and put it online. Museums just don't have the resources.
Okay, on to the... okay, that's fine. Go ahead. Sorry. And I'm not sure what physical structure this is that this guy's standing on.
Probably the Araby Tower.
That's possible. Were there two towers or one tower?
There was an Araby Tower, and then eventually in late 46 they had an actual gantry.
Uh-huh.
So it could have been done from the actual gantry, which was built later.
Mm-hmm. And here you see the mountains in the background, which were the part of the... actually, this is way above sea level, as I recall.
It's about a mile up.
Yeah. Way above sea
between
level.
Las Cruces and Alamogordo. So.
So actually, you could get a little more altitude off the rocket because you didn't have to plow through an extra mile of atmosphere. Okay. There it goes. This is exciting, guys. You can find the next one. Okay, so it's almost directed here. Notice there's not a lot of stuff around here. It doesn't look like Cape Canaveral in the 60s. Okay, hold it. So there it is, you know, and the desert sky, and you can see the fins and everything. My dad. Let me insert two comments here while we're looking at this. This thing is approximately, well, it's probably a little offset above the ground, and it was, I think, 46 feet long. And Dad was up there, I think, the instrumentation, of course, must have... one thing I don't know is whether this stuff was radioed to the ground or whether they were trying to recover the nose cone with reported data. And since they were trying to get reentry information, you know, they weren't blowing the nose cone at 100 miles on this thing unless they were looking at the temperature going out. So I'm not sure how the data recovery was handled on this, but it must have all gone into some central unit in the nose. And he was working up there, and this is something that I just realized today that I don't understand. Was so it, this may have been on the, this comment may have related to the Araby rather than the B2. But what I remember was that he said that he was working up there, and there were squibs, explosive bolts. And he had checked to make sure the test equipment he was using wouldn't trigger the squibs, because that would ruin your whole day.
Yep, EMF is bad.
And it might be your last day, too, and it would kind of slow down the launch a little bit. So he's up there, and this tech sergeant comes by, and he says, "What are you doing?" And I said, "Oh, I've checked it." And the guy looks at him and says, "Those voltages are too high." The guy had given him misinformation, and he could have blown. And the other thing was, he said, he didn't like being up there. If you've ever, like, gone out on a fire escape, you know, the kind where you can kind of look through the grid downward, this was probably a lot worse than that. So you're about four stories up, and you look down, and you're kind of, there's not much to give you confidence. So he didn't like that. And it probably one of these kind of vehicles was what he was lying under when he watched his first launch. Nice desert sky. Thanks, my friend.
And I think they would have used the gantry rather than that leaning ladder to get up to it at that point. So this may be
it's possible that because I'm sure between the time he became project engineer and the time that he was actually out there, there must have been 3 or 6 months. Mm-hmm. So it's very possible that you're right, and this isn't that special round that crashed, and that this is a little bit earlier. I'm pretty sure that it's probably got to be mid 47 or later, but that would be before 25 is possible. Okay, that's interesting. And notice back up a second. From this side, is this black? I can't tell whether that's black on this side. They're both white here.
That's probably a fin that's black on both sides, because in that time period, there'd be one fin black on both sides, and then that part of the tail section would be white, and then the other side would have that checkered look.
Because this fin looks like it's white on this side, but I'm not sure. On the other side, but then maybe it'll be
white.
Okay, next. So, I think, there's one guy up there who's doing something on the round. Here we see one of the black fins. Go ahead. Well, so things are getting exciting at this point. They're taking down the gantry. Very, very nice picture. So this shows you the stuff at the base, the hydraulic jacks and various... I wonder what that thing is there.
I believe that was an umbilical... I think they would catch an umbilical that fell off the rocket. It shows up in the photos of most launches.
Mm-hmm. Next one, please. So this is kind of an overview of the launch site. So this, I think, is the blockhouse. It had very, very thick walls. But again, you can see this pioneering effort that there's not... It's things are simple in these days. It was complicated compared to the stuff that they might have been doing in the 20s and 30s. But go ahead. Yeah, I think that guy was supposed to pat the rocket and say goodbye to it. Next one, please. I have no idea what they're up to at this point. Go ahead. Next, please. So again, this is one of those high shot. Next. Okay, now we're getting serious.
That's the side opposite of the black pen.
Uh-huh, yeah, this is a good picture of that thing, and the umbilical is the only connection now. Drifting away. Go ahead. So there's, I can't tell whether it's actually left the ground or not at this point. This may be pre-stage. Because when there'll be stuff out farther out here, or it may even be before that. Next one. So there she goes. Yeah, that's fine. So now the round is left, and people are approaching the thing, and then, go ahead. I don't know what that flare indicates. Maybe it's an all clear.
Yeah, there's. I know there's a signal that indicates.
Did somebody say something? Okay. So here is the. Presumably, this is somewhere near the crash site or landing site, whatever you want to call it. There's some stuff. The thing. This doesn't look like a crater to me. So to me, that says either maybe they blew the nose cone off. And I don't know how much. I think, weren't they blowing the nose cones off of some of them? And then the thing would kind of drift down. And
that was the theory, yeah.
So I don't know what the crash site from those looked like as compared to the crash site of something that didn't get up very high and didn't have a lot of kinetic energy and fought back on the desert and made a big ball of fire, but not much of an impact.
That charred grass in the background? Is that a sign of fire?
That's what it looks like, but there seems to be kind of a strip of stuff down here. I don't know what it is. Okay, next one, please. There's some more of that. Oh, you're suggesting that, well, there was still some propellant even in a normal round when it hit that might have burned off. I don't know. But again, it doesn't look like a crater kind of impact to me. So whatever it was didn't hit going very fast. Next one, please. This is a Stinson L5 reconnaissance aircraft, so he's obviously overflying the site. It's just a kind of a cute little touch. So you see, this thing did. So everybody's standing around and looking at their ill-gotten gains. Yeah, I don't know. This may just be natural pickup. Again, one possibility, assuming that's the nose cone, is that this thing crashed at low velocity and this thing was sort of tossed off to the side. And the other would be that it parachuted down, but I don't see a harness or anything, so that doesn't look like that's what happened. Well, I'm not sure. I mean, this just looks like it's a hill that this thing tossed up. Because, see, there's nothing. This is sort of a mound, but I don't see any depression on this side. So I'm not sure that that's what happened. So this is. Oh, okay. This is the motor, which, of course, was a pretty strong thing. But again, it doesn't look like it hit with any kind of velocity.
It could have been going flat, too.
Exactly.
Instead of going down, it could have flattened out a little bit.
Yeah. But if the nose cone was still on, the fins were still on, it would have come straight down and crashed at very high speed. Next one. Oh, yeah, definitely nose cone. And definitely hit going very fast. You know, it might have gotten that much damage at 30 miles an hour, but not at 300, and certainly not at 2,000. Go ahead. So there, back up for a second. Okay, this is a better picture of what we were talking about before. I guess this here, that might be a crater there, and it may have been moved, or maybe it flopped down where it is. I'm not sure. Go ahead. Okay, that's pretty much it. I think there may be some. Oh, I think this is somebody horsing around. I'm not sure. Is that the last one, or is there another? And here's somebody playing with some desert plant. Boys will have their fun. I'm not sure how relevant this stuff is. Okay, so that's the V2 stories. I don't know if there's anybody here who's going to appreciate this, but. How much time does anybody have?
We've got about 20 minutes.
Okay, so I can kind of banter on. I just wanted to show this. If any of you remember Len Feskin, who was the Feskin's Malowicki equations, and also the fiasco, I think this was at the Wallops Nationals. He and Hank Isaacs, and actually his father, they built a scale Aerobee launcher and a couple of Aerobee models. And Dust Devil knocked the launcher, you know, it was like probably a 10-foot tall launcher, knocked that over, and then something bad happened to one of the other Aerobees, and then one of the Aerobees they finally launched, except it had a system, that, you know, there's a gap between the booster on an Aerobee and the upper stage. So they had a system where the upper stage had a fuse in it, and the lower stage had an electrical igniter, and Len was supposed to get there and figure out when the fuse was the right one. And then launched the lower stage. So, of course, it goes up, and of course, he didn't wait long enough, which is what always happens with something like that. He didn't wait long enough. And so the thing, when it was about like this, I wasn't there, but then the upper stage fired. But this is a nice, this model was never built, but it was, it's just a... I was in touch with Len recently, and I'm going to send this back to him after the thing. But if anybody wants to build a P2, and I will mention one of the greatest unbuilt projects in model rocketry. Of course, we used to have bull sessions, and one day this was the MIT Rocket Society. So one day we were walking over to one of the restaurants in Temple Square. Somebody says, well, this is 1 pound weight limit days, what's the biggest model rocket you could build? And I was always kind of a lightweight fanatic and carried some numbers around in my head. Said, well, let's say if you make it out of thin styrofoam piece, I don't know, 16th or an eighth of an inch. So the calculation came out, you know, it was, and you could put, we were figuring like a bee in it or something like that, the smallest model that you might be able to fly a 1 pound rocket for a few seconds. C's weren't out yet. There were some bigger motors, but they would have been added weight. So it came out, I don't know, 6 feet tall V2, something like that. So then I said, well, what if you put hydrogen in it? And again, this was a top of the head calculation. You have to go back and check. It came out just about neutral buoyancy. So the fantasy was you have this rocket, sits on the launcher, it's just a little bit heavier than air. The engine fires and it sort of warms up. We didn't figure out how far. But let's say it goes 10 feet. But now it's lighter than air. Because it's burned up. But then here's the cool part. You channel the ejection charge into the main chamber. So the model sits there, it takes off, it starts drifting away, and all of a sudden, puff, it's gone. I love the idea. So, I'll talk a little bit about the ARB. The ARB was actually, and they have a nice one at the, they have an early one at Wright-Patterson. And there had been a rocket program in at Caltech that began, I'm thinking around 38, something like that. You know, it was young guys who were excited by it, and they had, their father figure was Theodore von Karman, who was one of the greatest applied scientists in aeronautics history. And they actually made some significant progress. They developed JATO bottles for helping launch heavy airplanes during the war. And then they started building solid fuel rockets, and there was the Corporal and the WAC Corporal. And the Navy was also getting into this thing. There was something called the Bumblebee, I think. So the Navy decided they wanted a nice sounding rocket based, I'm not sure how much it was based on the WAC Corporal, but it was a very similar thing for the Corporal. it was a very similar thing conceptually. So it was an unguided rocket that kept it very simple. And they had this tall tower, which you can see in those pictures. And it had solid fuel boosters. So the solid fuel booster would very quickly get up to speed. By the time it left the tower, it would be well stabilized by aerodynamic forces at fairly decent speeds. And then it would just shoot straight up and go straight up. And what was it good for, about 100 kilometers, something like that? Maybe even a little more. And it became a workhorse and went through a lot of versions, and they fired hundreds or thousands of Arabs. So it was an important tool of atmospheric exploration and some of the other early research. So I don't know why my dad was brought in on that, but I believe he was on two rounds. He was on the first Air Force round, December 2nd, 1949, which was just a little bit after the Navy started flying them. And on a second round, which I think might have been the Air Force round three. And a kid, Peter Alway, because in this book, which is a very wonderful book, and if you don't own it, is there a version in print?
Yes, it is available from Barnes. I even have copies I brought with me.
It's a fabulous book. But it was very amusing because he has, the other thing that I don't have here is there's a movie, and my dad's in it, there's a movie of that, December 2nd, 1949. Right now. But, so, he has this picture of that round, and it's one of the rockets, I think it's this one, that's illustrated, and it has this red stripe on the side. And I think you say it's up both sides. I'm not sure that's right. Well, if you look at his drawing and if you look at the photograph very carefully, the nose cone is wrong. And the reason I know that is this is the nose cone he painted, but it wasn't the nose cone in the photograph. They took this nose. This is on backwards. It's actually. Apparently they put, I have no idea what reasons, but they put a fiberglass experimental nose cone on that rocket, so it was probably brown. And so Dad used to put this thing, he would screw it on this way so he could use it as a desk mount. This actually goes on this way. I'm not going to screw it all the way down, but you can see the point. And I have a couple of little stories about the Araby from when he was involved in the project. One of them was that Dad had, as I mentioned, a background in automobiles. And he actually, during the Depression, he and a friend of his had a garage for a while. He was the mechanic. I guess his friend Saul, I forget his last name. Anyway, they couldn't make a go of it. This was during the Depression. It was very difficult. His friend later became the ice cream king of Cleveland. And Dad went on to his other successes. Well, he got a commendation from the BU guy, and I think one reason was that he found out that the circuitry they were using could theoretically, not necessarily, but it was conceivable, they would blow the nose cone when the thing left the tower, and that would have been very embarrassing. The nose with the instrument and payload. And the other story, which I love, was they had the range up and they were ready to go, and they had a pressure leak in the instrument compartment. And my guess is that the reason that was a problem was that in a vacuum, you tend to get electrical discharges. You need much more highly insulated electrical systems. So it may have been if this thing leaked, it would have short-circuited at altitude. They had a big problem on ignition systems and fighter planes at high altitude during World War II for that reason. So, and they had the radar going, and I guess you had to arrange in advance for the radar guys. So Dad comes over and he says, there's these potential external conduits, which I think was what he was referring to. And he says, well, this bracket here, what does that bracket do? And I said, well, it doesn't do much. So he gets a cold chisel. Knocks the bracket off. He must have, my guess is there were some other bolts or something involved. And he just stuffed some automotive body.
Hondo, basically.
Yeah. Some filler into the crack that was leaking. And then they put the thing back together and launched it. And I think that pretty much covers it. I will end with it's more of a family story than a rocket story, but it's just sort of interesting that kind of, you know, as a kind of lower mid-level guys, the interesting things that you could see in that period from the base here. He was based, as I said, at Wright-Patterson the whole time. I grew up probably less than a mile from the hotel in a location on the university campus that's now a parking lot, but it was a government project that was built during the war. They built these things that looked like barracks buildings, and they divided them up into little about the size of a medium-sized closet. There was no tub. You could shower or you could bathe in a metal tub. The walls were so thin that I could talk to the next door through the bedroom wall at night. But it was an interesting environment because there were fairly different kinds of people there. There was a school up through third grade on the base, and they had a movie theater and a dormitory for single women. One of the biggest scandals during the 12 years that I was there was somebody once stole a tricycle. People left their doors unlocked. But anyway, they were working on a program called the Bumper, which eventually set the speed record and the altitude record. It was a two-stage vehicle. It used the V2 and then a WAC corporal on top. Did the Russians, before Sputnik, did the Russians ever beat that altitude? Well, before 56, let's say. It may have been the record until he started building intermediate range ballistic missiles and long range and ICBMs and so forth. So he had some kind of involvement with that. So they sent him out to California because they were Patrick Air Force Base was involved. So he gets a call from his brother-in-law in Cleveland, and he was involved in real estate there. And so his brother says, well, there's this guy named Diamond. Diamond was a big shot in Cleveland real estate after World War II. And Diamond owned a hotel in Florida, and the staff was robbing him blind, and apparently my uncle had told Diamond that my dad was a clever guy, and so they set up a meeting. So Dad, on the same trip where he's dealing with his stuff at Patrick Air Force Base, he goes in this hotel, so there's this whole hotel, it's closed down. Diamond, the real estate guy, is staying there by himself. And he says, well, Carl, I just want to get out of this thing. I was having trouble with the staff, but if somebody was overseeing it, I think it could do okay. And what we could do is I could sell it to you, and we could arrange the payments so that you could pay for it out of the profits. and I'm sure, you know, with an active management, it would do fine, and it would be easy for you. And Dad was sort of tempted, but he decided, that's not really my business. He turned him down. Well, that would have been about 1950. And, of course, that location became Cape Canaveral. So in about 5 years, we would have been doing really well. Does anybody have any questions or comments?
I missed the beginning, but when did your dad is not alive anymore?
He died in 1988. Go ahead.
So I was wondering about these pictures, and if you had a chance to talk to him about these slides. These are all slides of his, I guess.
Yeah. The slides were earlier in the project because he wanted to understand exactly what was going on. So an army photographer took these slides. Dad was not actually on location for that one. He was on location for three subsequent ones. I have to fill in two more. Does that answer the question?
Yes. How long was he at White Sands?
He would go out there on what's called TDY. So I'm not sure. I haven't tried to, from the postcards, maybe I can figure something out. My guess is that he probably went out there for something like a week or, you know, several days to a couple of weeks, but I don't know exactly what the time would be. There, on something like this, there could be more than one project engineer because the vehicle could be involved in multiple programs at the same time. So
he took the train, didn't he? He didn't fly.
Well, it's the late 40s. I think he probably took the train. I do know he...
It's about 2 days, 3 days.
He was involved in a couple of... And if anybody's interested, they can ask me afterwards. He was involved in a couple of... He was not in flight test engineering, but he went on a couple of flight tests that ended up with him being very sick. And one of the funny things was that the older planes had there was no nose wheel, so he would sit down like this. And he used to say when he would sit down in a DC-3, as soon as he would sit down at an angle, he would start getting airsick. One of the things that I forgot and left out, which is anybody of a weak heart should leave the room because this is a terrible tragedy. He pulled out of the crater, he pulled out a piece of V2 skin that he saved, which had... The thermocouple actually burned out, I think, but it had the bolt, so it showed the installation. So we have the slides and the model, but there was also the piece of skin that had been in space. And back around the 60s, it started getting a little rusty, so I sprayed it with clear Krylon, which stabilized it. It was in a funny little cabinet down in the basement. And when Mom broke up the house in 92, I had to clean out things that she wouldn't have room for it anymore. So I went down in the basement, I opened the little cabinet, and it was gone. And she must have, somebody, probably Mom, had probably gone. The only two things she ever threw out were the V2 skin and the World War II Batman comics. But it's not so bad because the Batman comics didn't have the covers.
Oh, well.
Still. But anyway, that's one of the great tragedies in my life.
Two tragedies.
I forgive her. She died 2 years ago at 100, and she's buried out here at Caroline Park. So, that's the story.